All right. Good day to you. God bless you. Hey, welcome to the Shepherd's Chapel. Welcome to this family Bible study hour. I'm enjoying these kind of specials we're doing and kind of updating some tapes that we did quite some time back. The appointed time. That's the subject. Anytime our Father states something in His Word, then the time element becomes very important. What appointed time? And of course, it's the question that man has asked since the beginning of time. When is the end going to be? Well, that's what the appointed time is. Our Father knows what that appointed time is. We don't. But He gives us many clues, and occasionally it doesn't hurt to go back, look at the times that He illustrated, mentioned, and gave an example of what it would be like at the appointed time. So I thought we would discuss that and look at it in connection with the day's current events as we teach it, whereby you can observe and know and perhaps have a better understanding of what's happening in the world, because it was written long ago concerning the appointed time. Now, the minor prophets are kind of like reading tomorrow's newspaper. There is more information in the minor prophets, so we're going to draw from one of those minor prophets, the one whose name was Habakkuk. Habakkuk means to embrace, and the truth expressed here, you had better embrace them, for they are your Father's word, His advice to you. And he discusses within this the events that were happening then, but letting you know it was only an example of what was going to happen at the appointed time. So that makes it very important. Just because we're in what some call the Old Testament, God never changes. He's the same yesterday, today, and He will be forever. His word remains forever. This earth age will depart, but this word, God's word, never departs. There is nothing new under the sun that our Father's word does not familiarize you with before the fact. So, with that having been said, the book of Habakkuk, we're going to start in chapter 1, verse 1. Let's see what we can draw from it. The burden which Habakkuk the prophet did see. A burden on who? Well, let's find out. Verse 2. O Lord, how long shall I cry, and thou wilt not hear, even cry out unto thee of violence, and thou wilt not save? In other words, that's what man, how long, Lord, until you return? How long, Lord, until you save us from the tribulations of this world? Well, violence, look around you today. Probably more so than any time in history, we even see children participating in violence. Why? Because the moments that we used to spend as a nation and multiple peoples, we were taught to respect each other and to appreciate the dignity of other races, of other peoples, and so forth. Unfortunately, since that dignity has been removed from the school systems, that you can't even have a moment's silence, and that's what should be, and taught to respect other people's beliefs, religions, thoughts, and peoples, then it has waned away. And rather than dignity and respect, we see confrontation, violence. The reason being, many times starting right at home. Verse 3. Why dost thou show me iniquity? Why do you let me see all this sin and violence? And cause me to behold grievance? That's to say, oppression. A mile in the Hebrew tongue. Injustice. Why do you let me see all this injustice? For spoiling and violence are before me. And there are that raise up strife and contention. Those things will always be with us until the appointed time. You can rest assured of that, but learning from your Father's Word, you will learn how to deal with those things. And Father will protect you even in this generation from many of those things if you understand what's happening in the world. Verse 4. Therefore the law is slack, and judgment doth never go forth. It seems like it's plea bargain here and put off there and never a stand here. And a murderer may have to maybe prolong the 20 years before he finally pays his price, as requested by God's word. For the wicked doth compass, it would seem that the wicked compass about the righteous, that there's more of them, yes. Therefore, wrong judgment proceedeth. We have in present day, rather than attaining to strict law, as law was originally taken from the Word of God, we now practice what is called the law of precedent. And precedence, regardless of what many might argue against this point, be that as it may, but I feel that precedents grow more lax and lax and lax, and at one time there was no such thing as a precedent set if the law said yea or nay. And that's the way it was. But we go by man's traditions and precedents in this day and time. And therefore it seems that justice is never done. Verse 5. Behold ye among the heathen, and regard the wonder marvelously. For I will work a work in your days which ye will not believe, though it be told you. In other words, before that time, even before that appointed time, God's going to work a work that most people wouldn't believe if you shared with them the information. And naturally, he's talking, well, let's let him say it. Verse 6. For lo, I raise up the Chaldeans, that bitter and hasty nation, which shall march through the breadth of the land to possess the dwelling places that are not theirs. Now, what is he talking about? Well, in the actual type that took place, we had a good idea. You could see it if you study history. But who were the Chaldeans? They were the Babylonians. That Babylon of the book of Revelation has spread throughout the land, which what is Babylon? It's Babel. Confusion. Confusion of law and justice. Confusion, even if you would, of our Father's very word, that the traditions of men which make void his absolute, that is to say, yea or nay on law, has even worked into the religious circles, whereby traditions of men and church organizations supersede the basic law and ways of God. Unfortunately, many would disagree with that, but it's true. How many of you attend church where you're taught God's Word chapter by chapter, verse by verse, or you go by a church quarterly? Now, perhaps that's a little unfair because there are good quarterlies, but I prefer to teach directly from the Word of God. So, thus confusion. A poor unbeliever, and anyone that is not Christian, was called a barbarian or a heathen, be that as it may be a little unkind by today's standards, but it simply means a non-believer. A non-believer in Yahweh, the living God. And unfortunately, you have many of those today. And the confusion goes throughout the nation, throughout the world. The reason I'm drawing on these things is I want you to see how modern this chapter is to this day when you take it in that futurist sense, that is to say, towards that time that God calls His appointed time. Verse 7. They are terrible and dreadful. Their judgment and their dignity shall proceed of themselves. they do as they wish, and no one can alter that. They set a law, you're judged by it, and that's the way it is. Many times the righteous do not win, but they always win if God is with you and you don't give up. God will always give you the victory. Verse 8, their horses also are swifter than the leopards. That means their power. Okay, horses are always symbolic of power, even as horns are. And are more furious, are keener than the evening wolves, always out for the kill. And their horsemen shall spread themselves, and their horsemen shall come from far. They shall fly as the eagle that hasteth to eat. Meaning, they're hungry. They're starving to consume you. How does that fit today? We're talking about eagles. We're talking about horsemen. How does confusion travel? Well, the media, the method of media which you're now observing, television, we push a button in Northwest Arkansas and cover a third of the Earth's surface, bam, just like that, in seconds. That's swifter than the eagle, well enough. And naturally, that media is most often used in other senses than carrying forth the Word of God. The word of Babel, confusion. It rings the earth now in nanoseconds. Well, that would be a little untrue, but in seconds. And so it is. It's come to pass. That's what I'm telling you. How many would have God said He would work this work that not many would believe at that time if they were told? How many people? At my birth, that is to say in the 20s, would say, yeah, we're going to hang a vessel out there in space 22,300 miles, and we're going to be able to shoot pictures up at it, and those pictures will be able to be observed in everyone's home. That would have been unbelievable. And now, all the way around the world, think about it. We grow so callous to new things, and many times they were written of long ago, worldwide. One worldism, the media, instant media is very necessary to bring about the new world order, and one worldism, and they are hungry for it and rush and hasten to it. Verse 9. They shall come all for violence. Their faces shall sup up as the east wind. That means they're eager, and the east wind is always hot. And they shall gather the captivity as the sand, or like sand. They will take captive with their confusion, their lies, the belief that they would cause people to believe in, to have faith in a new world order to bring peace, peace. You've heard it many times. 10. And they shall scoff at the kings, and the princes shall be a scorn unto them. They shall deride every stronghold, for they shall heap dust and take it. That means whatever mound, like it used to a wall, they would build a mound and walk right over it. All right. When you see the four hidden dynasties of the end times, and you're familiar with them from our Father's Word, the hidden dynasty of the political, the economy, world economy, I'm speaking, the dynasty of education, and the dynasty of religion. When you see that dynasty of the economy today, as you see world trade, is just a common statement that anyone can trade anywhere, and the super officials of GATT have the ability to correct people regardless of what the president, the Congress, or anyone might say of a nation. This has come to pass. And on it goes. They take it. They override opposition. Verse 11. Then shall his mind change, and he shall pass over and offend, imputing this his power unto his God. In other words, we're going to see a false God come into being. You know it if you've studied with me any length of time, the false Messiah, verse 12. Art thou not from everlasting, O Lord God, mine Holy One? This is his prayer. We shall not die. O Lord, thou hast ordained them for judgment. And it is written he has. And O mighty God, thou hast established them for correction. He begins to remember God's word rather than crying into his soup or being all caught up in the activity, the evil activities of today. To know that God told you long ago that the superpowers would do exactly what they're doing. That we would come into this new world order. That the world economy would be not visible to most, but a one world economy. And if you don't think we're building to that, you've been asleep in the last year. You're living in those times, verse 13. Habakkuk begins to realize that God said, hey, this is going to happen. I'm allowing them to do this to try to get people's attention, to give them a little paddling that they'll turn back to me rather than the false one. Thou art of purer eyes than to behold evil. He's kind of apologizing here. And canst not look on iniquity. Wherefore lookest thou upon them that deal treacherously, and holdest thy tongue when the wicked devoureth the man that is more righteous than he? The Antichrist will try to destroy or convert. That's how you work confusion, is by conversion. 14. And makest men, Adam in Hebrew, as the fishes of the sea. Have you ever seen the little fishes in this thing yet? They have a school and the whole one little fish turns this way and the whole bunch turns this way. This little fish turns that way. They all turn that way. They all swim. As the creeping things, and usually when they migrate, they all creep and go together, that have no ruler over them. It would appear that that's the way people are of this world, that do not realize they have a destiny, that God has a purpose, that things are happening by his perfect order of things, by allowing the chaos that you see, when all you have to do is turn to him and rise above it. If you would, even a form of resurrecting, raising to a higher level of thinking, and bringing yourself above, using common sense and his protecting wing. 15. They take up all of them with the angle. You know what that is? They catch them in their net, the whole little bunch. The peoples of the world swim into their little net and gather them in their drag, a dragnet. Therefore, they rejoice and are glad. And so it is with the world, the new world order, setting up the one world system for its one world ruler. And that's the subject here. You have read it in both the New Testament and the Old. You have heard it repeated that he will have this power of almost hypnotizing, if you would, with his flood of lies as they pour from his mouth, as recorded in Revelation chapter 12, to entrap even the elect, if that were possible. It is not. 16. Therefore, they sacrifice unto their net. Not God, but to their system. Their system is the theme. And burn incense unto their drag, the liberalism of the world burning and worshiping the way rather than Almighty God. Because by them their portion is fat, and their meat plenteous. Why? The people are ready to swallow anything, hook, line, and sinker, that seems new. And when they are in confusion, it is common nature that a human being must hang on to something. They must believe in something. And it would seem that because the so-called church has received such a bad reputation, don't think it's any accident that the church has been given a so-called bad reputation, that people are almost unpopular to call themselves a Christian. It's planned. They have the little schools of fishes swim away from the real Word of God. And many times, men were lied about that brought the reputation upon their character, and they were not strong enough to kick in the teeth the offender and push them away from them. Lies cannot prevail against truth. But that's what's happened. They worship their one world, new world order, their oneness, more so than the Father Himself, the creator of their very being. That is ignorance in its highest degree. They worship the God of forces, as it is written in Daniel chapter 11, verse 17. Shall they therefore empty their net and not spare continually to slay the nations? Will they let their little fishes go? Question. Not until God kicks some sense in their head. Now, that may offend some to hear it stated that way, but that's exactly what the time appointed is for. Chapter 2, verse 1, the thought continues. I will stand upon my watch and set me upon the tower and will watch to see what he will say unto me. That's to say, what God will answer me and what I shall answer when I am reproved. In other words, this is what a watchman is supposed to do. It's what you're supposed to do. When you see this going on, you're supposed to watch, observe, and see God's overall plan unfolding before your very eyes. And only a person that is biblically illiterate and blind to God's teachings cannot see today. It does not take much of a watchman to see the unfolding of the appointed time. Verse 2, and the Lord answered me. Now comes the answer. Listen up. And said, write division and make it plain upon tablets. You write it large. Put it on a signboard where people can see. And make it plain upon tablets that he may run that readeth it. In other words, let it be a warning when you see the false Messiah, the false one world ruler, when all peoples are running into his net of deception and lies. 3, for the vision is yet for an appointed time. There is our subject. An appointed time. But at the end, it shall speak and not lie. In other words, you can count on the word of God. You will see these things come to pass. Though it tarry, wait for it. That requires patience. Do you have it? Because it will surely come. It will not tarry. How are you fixed, friend? That's the word of God. You're living in that time today. That the appointed time grows closer and closer and closer. I want you to turn back with me to the book of Daniel, where again this great prophet is speaking. We're going to take it at verse chapter 8, verse pick it up at 19. This is the time that Daniel is talking about the coming and appearing of this same false one that comes in by governmental peace. That is to say, the spurious Messiah. Verse 19. And he said, "Behold, I will make thee know what shall be in the last end of the indignation, for at the time appointed," I repeat, "at the time appointed, the end shall be." Now, that's the question of men. What is he talking about? Now, if we can, I want you to roll the character generator ahead. You would have been warned of Media Persia, which is Iran, Iraq of today, of how the battles of the would go on there from the king of Greece. Huh? But I want to come right down to the subject matter for the sake of time. Move ahead to the 23rd verse. Move ahead to the 23rd verse, and I'll let you catch me there as I begin to teach. Nation will stand out against nation, but not in his power, but in the power of God as he brings nations into the one world, new world order. The appointed time is very near the end. So I come for this specific subject to verse 23. And in the latter time of their kingdom, that one world system, when the transgressors are come to the full, that's to say their little net is full, they have it well under control, a king of furious countenance and understanding dark sentences shall stand up. And of course, this is the spurious Messiah. He is the one that heals the deadly wound to the new world order that is received, I feel, very not too far in the distant future. Verse 24, and his power shall be mighty, but not by his own power. In other words, he sets up a false Godhead, and God allows it. God allows it to check out his children to see how well they are familiar with the letter that he has written. And he shall destroy wonderfully. How does he do it? And shall prosper and practice and shall destroy the mighty and the holy people. He's going to try it. He will deceive many of them. And you might say, if it were possible, he would do this. God will not allow that. 25. And through his policy also, he shall cause craft to prosper in his hand. He's going to work miracles. Big daddy of religion. And he shall magnify himself in his heart. That's been Satan's problem from the beginning of time. Pride in Ezekiel 28, 18 and 19 brought about his downfall in the first earth age. How does he do all this? And by peace. Let me say that again. And by peace shall destroy many. And he shall also stand up against the prince of princes. But he shall be broken without hand. Do you know why? Because God will do it at the appointed time. But by peace, by world peace, 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 into a one world system where there is no nation aside from it that can war against another nation. 26. And the vision of the evening and the morning, which was told, is true. Wherefore shut thou up the vision, for it shall be for many days. In other words, it's going to be a long ways away, Daniel. Well, we're a long ways away from Daniel's days, 2,500 years plus. And we are at that time where the signs of the appointed time are very prominent. And I don't say this to frighten anyone, because you don't have to be afraid. Example, what is this evening and morning? It's talking about the evening and the morning oblation. Do you know what that is? That's the evening and the morning offering to God. What did that become? Question. It became the offering for sin. That was done away with by who? By the true Christ. Hebrews chapter 10. That he became the offering for one and all times. But it would be the imposter of that offering. The spurious Messiah. In pride saying, I am God, or as it is written in 2 Thessalonians chapter 2, sitting on Mount Zion showing the world that he is God with his supernatural capabilities. You know that Daniel, we're going to turn ahead to the 11th chapter of Daniel. I'm zeroing in on the subject, the appointed time, all right? We're going to find in this 11th chapter, which leads to the same appearing of the same one. You'll remember one understanding the dark sentences. You'll remember that Paul said that's the purpose of the gospel armor, is to have it on, that we don't fight against the power of the arm, but dark sentences and sayings from high places, meaning angelic beings, such as this one. Verse 24 of Daniel chapter 11. He shall enter peaceably. This is that same one that conquers by peace, one worldism. Even upon the fattest places of the province, and he shall do that which his fathers have not done, nor his fathers' fathers. He shall scatter among them the prey, and spoil, and riches. Yea, and he shall forecast his devices against the strongholds even for a time, up until, if I may add, the appointed time. Verse 25. And he shall stir up his power and his courage against the king of the south with a great army. And the king of the south shall be stirred up to battle with a great, very great and mighty army, but he shall not stand. Nobody makes a stand. Now, for they, who is this they? They are the Kenites. For they shall forecast devices against him. Why? Because of the one world system. We're talking here about the confrontation of Ezekiel 38 and 39. Many might say, well, that will never come to pass. Now, for even as those whose children were in the womb of the mother, God predicted they would each become a strong nation, and that they would fight against each other. Don't worry, it will happen. But they still won't make a stand. Verse 26. Yea, they that feed of the portion of his meat shall destroy him, and his army shall overflow, and many shall fall down slain. In other words, by deception, by lies, they will fall right into his hand, believing what? That he is God. 27, and both these kings' hearts shall be to do mischief, and they shall speak lies at one table, but it shall not prosper, for yet the end shall be at the time appointed. That's why we came here. Appointed time. Want to have a little clue? 28. Then shall he return into his own land, his land, rather, with great riches, and his heart shall be against the holy covenant, and he shall do exploits and return to his own land. Do you know what? The exploits against the covenant of who? The true God, the Word of God. Those, God's election. Verse 29, at the time appointed, he shall return and come toward the south, and it shall not be as the former or the latter. But if we were to continue and we're not, the ships of Chittim, which in the Hebrew tongue is the bruisers. And who bruises Satan? God's elect. Praise God for them. God's elect will have their portion in the end times with those prophecies. Why do I do this? To frighten people? No. But to prepare you and know that there is nothing to fear other than fear itself, for God has foretold us in His Word of the appointed time and exactly what you're supposed to do. No need to fear, no need to run, but to stand bold, to make a stand and to make a difference by understanding His Word and knowing those signs, figures, symbols, and events that are happening in your life today are signs that point to the very appointed time. We'll pick this up in the next lecture. Hey, if I were you, I wouldn't miss it. All right, bless your hearts. You listen a moment, won't you please?